let's talk about the scary word fear. And when that comes into play into your business, how do you address it? So we already talked about in the previous video how to identify your beliefs, because a lot of your fears come from your subconscious thoughts and what your beliefs are. So once you kind of identify those, that's the first step in addressing fear and getting rid of it. So one of the biggest fears that I feel like business owners have is the fear of failure. So let's kind of talk about what that means and what exactly failure means.
I think that failure is such an interesting idea. And coming back to the beliefs thing that you're going to explore in the video regarding beliefs, that's where you're going to find out a lot of what you personally believe on failure. But the thing about failure is that our ideas surrounding failure stem from basically our childhood, the way that our parents viewed failure, or what they viewed failure as, is our grandparents, the people that were closest to us. And then as we started going through school, like what was viewed as failure and not failure. And as a business owner, failure is relative in the respect that I personally believe that failure is one of those things that, regardless of what you've been taught or what you feel, failure is something that you need to embrace. We all talk about education and we constantly need to be educated and everybody goes to college and all that. The reality is that failure in and of itself
real life education.
Is real life education. I once heard somebody say, they asked him, if you could go back and do it all again, what would you do differently? And the guy said, I would fail much bigger, much faster. And so this idea of failure
being something that you should fear is actually incorrect.
Yeah, it's something.
You actually want to embrace failure.
Yeah, you want to embrace the idea of failure. That doesn't mean that you try to fail,
no.
But what it does mean is that
failure is actually good. It produces growth.
Yes.
Failure is where you learn and you grow so that you're better and you don't make the same mistake again. So failure is good. You don't necessarily want to go out looking for it, but you definitely want to not fear it and not feel bad if something happens that didn't go the way that you wanted it to. That just look at, instead of feeling bad about it, look at it as an opportunity to get better and an opportunity to improve, for sure.
And whenever you make the mental shift regarding what is a failure, what isn't a failure, then you can shift. Like I know for us, and we've had our own sort of ups and downs with the idea of what has been failure, because as we talked about in the first video, we've gone from very, very, very successful in life to having some struggles and then having to come back. And what we really realize at some point, if you choose to, is that each failure is an opportunity for growth, yes, but it's an opportunity for you to learn something that you can take forward into the future and have better and better and better results with what you're doing and what you're trying to achieve. So the idea of failure and fearing it, you really have to just take a moment and start recognizing, like, hey, I'm worried about failure, but what does failure even mean? Because failure doesn't really mean anything. Like,
well,
what's the worst case scenario?
Well, and failure is only defined by you. But
right.
What we fear is what failure is defined by, what everybody else defines as failure. So you could feel like your failure is a good thing, and then you actually think about what everybody else thinks, and then it becomes a bad thing. So you have to like not even care what everybody else thinks and just focus on how you can improve.
Yeah.
So I feel like that fear is more about what everybody else thinks and not necessarily about how it's going to help you.
Also, coming to the idea of fear, whether it's failure or many of the other things, obstacles that you're going to face as a business owner, fear in and of itself, I think you have to recognize that you're having some fear, and then ultimately, the best way to get over fear is to, what's the worst case scenario? What's the worst case scenario? And when you really, truly recognize what's the worst case scenario of whatever you're attempting to do that you're worried about failing at, then you can move forward in a completely different way. Because as human beings, we have this tendency to, we just start feeling a certain way. We sort of feel some angst, our heart starts beating faster. We sort of start sweating or whatever it is. We sort of have these biochemical reactions like she does to things. But we're not actually recognizing like, hey, this is the worst possible scenario of what could happen. Like, Law's not recognizing that the worst possible scenario of what could happen of Law shooting this video is one of you guys makes fun of her. Oh, well.
It's not a big deal. If you don't like me or you don't like how I'm actually doing the video, then it really doesn't matter. So, I mean, I know that, but it's still sometimes hard to do. So,
but when you recognize the worst case scenario, then that's that moment when, hey, you can just release it. Because, you know, like, this is the worst thing.
Well, worst case scenario in your shoot. Let's just go there, because that's something that I've gone through. I've feared, what if I don't get enough good pictures of my client? Or what if my, camera messes up? So the worst thing that can happen really is A, I give them their money back, or B, we just reshoot. And it's actually happened before. So backing up your pictures on two different hard drives, definitely do that. I lost everything on my computer and I had not backed it up yet. And so I had to reshoot three shoots that I lost all the pictures of. My clients were actually very understanding and completely fine with it. So my worst fear was really, it wasn't that bad actually. It kind of sucked, but it definitely wasn't as bad as like I was imagining in my head. So I definitely learned from that and I won't do that again. But fear is really easily addressed when you learn how to address it correctly. So another fear I feel like a lot of photographers have is, like I said, and that not being good enough or their pictures not turning out as well as they want them to. And really all you have to do is address that fear. How can you eliminate that fear? You can eliminate that fear by doing some practice shoots. You can eliminate that fear by improving your skills. You can eliminate that fear by getting to know your camera better. And once you get more confident, then that fear is going to go away. So easily addressing your fear by just improving your skills.
And again, coming back to sort of that tip of worst case scenario is you take some pictures and you're not happy with them. The reality is that when you come to somebody and you communicate with integrity about what it is that you're feeling, 99 out of 100 times, people are going to respond very, very well and love you on a completely different level for that level of that integrity of your communication regarding what happened. So for some reason you didn't get pictures that you're in love with, if you come back to the person and say, hey, I didn't get the pictures that I want, I want to do another shoot with you, or I'm going to refund your money, that will empower you on a level that you have no possible idea, because you're going to get rid of the fear. But also people respond to that because it's so rare to have that kind of integrity in your communication in this day and age.
Integrity in general. When you put your clients first, they're going to appreciate that.
Yeah.
Like, I shoot natural light, and there are days, even in Vegas, even though it's like the fourth sunniest place on earth, that there are too many clouds for me to shoot. And if I have a shoot, I tell my clients, I'm really, really sorry, but in order for me to give you the most gorgeous images in my style, then I shoot natural light. And this is kind of one of the byproducts. The lighting is just not good enough for me to give you the most gorgeous images. And I'm not willing to just give you subpar images. And my clients are always 100% thankful, and they usually say thank you. I really appreciate the fact that you aren't willing to just take my money and give me subpar pictures, but you're concerned and are willing to wait and give me the best pictures you possibly can. So your clients are going to respect that because you're putting them first. And I tell them, you're investing in these pictures, so I'm not just gonna give you something, I'm gonna give you my absolute best. So
Yeah, so I think that kind of covers, you covered skill a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Also, skill kind of goes along with, if you feel like you're not good enough, then like, how can you make yourself feel good enough? Like, if you're fearful, or you're like, man, I just don't know that I'm good enough for this, then okay, what are you going to do about it?
Like, practice.
Michael Jordan didn't become the best basketball player by sitting there and worrying about it. He went and practiced.
Mm-hmm.
You know, go and practice. And there's tons of ways to go and practice, but practice your art, practice your craft. And that's an easy one right there to mm-hmm. turn around. I think a big thing for business owners and everybody is this idea of investing in your business. Because when you're an entrepreneur, it's night and day different from having a job where you know with reasonable certainty that you're going to get paid every 2 weeks or 30 days. I don't even know what people get paid, but like two weeks or 30 days. Anyway, however it is, you know with reasonable certainty that paycheck's going to come in, you know how much it is, and you kind of know what your expenses are. Whereas as a business owner, sometimes you're going to have to take what feels like a risk, and you're going to have to invest some money into advertising or into some equipment, and it's going to feel uncomfortable because there's no guarantee that you're going to get that money back. And what I always tell her, for us, and then also about everybody, is it boggles my mind how people will go and drop money on random things and not think twice about whether they're going to get their money back. But when it comes to their business and investing in their business, now all of a sudden, they're really, really worried about, am I going to get my money back? Every single day, everyone spends money on stuff that you're never going to get that money back. And it wasn't mandatory. It's a liability. We have a big screen TV on our wall. Trust me, it wasn't a mandatory purchase. If it meant the difference between investing in a big screen TV or investing in our business, we would have invested in our business.
Well, I kind of worked around that. So my big screen TV is what I do my reveals on. So I got to write it off as a business expense.
True.
But we'll go into how to do that later. You need to get profitable before you start getting creative with your taxes and your write-offs. But the key is like what he was saying, is that people will go out and spend thousands of dollars on a flat screen TV for their personal use and not think twice about putting it on a credit card or think twice about using their cash to pay for it. But when it comes to investing, you know, a couple thousand dollars into their business, then they get really fearful of parting with that money. Whereas when you go and spend money on a big screen TV, you're never going to get that money back, and most likely you're going to replace it in 5 years. Or less when the new technology comes out, versus when you invest that money into your business,
sky's the limit.
I was gonna say, the sky's the limit as far as how that can give you a return. So investing that money into yourself, investing that money into your business is going to give you an ROI, a return on investment,
and it's
much more likely than a TV or furniture or, you know, many other things that we spend money on, food, alcohol.
Yeah, I mean, it's smaller. It's not even always thousands of dollars. I mean, to spend money on advertising your business, to get customers that come and pay you money to do what you do, what you want to do, that's not even thousands of dollars, but it can mean the difference between a really nice meal out to eat or a medium meal, and you take the difference of that money and you know that you're going to invest it in advertising.
I think too, probably a lot of fear comes from, if you don't really understand business or marketing and you're trying to understand it, you're trying to make things work, and you have invested some money into marketing or advertising, and you don't see that return, then it becomes a fear to invest more. So the key here to eliminate that fear is to get educated on where you should put that money, where you should invest in your business for the best return. So obviously you're doing that right now in the boot camp and learning where to invest your marketing dollars, learning where to invest your money in your business so that you can get a return on investment. So to address that fear, if you have it going forward, just look to someone who has already done what you want to do and educate yourself on what it is that you can invest in that's going to give you that return.
I think that's 100% true. Obviously, we've laid out an extraordinary plan, but as you move forward in your business 5, 10, 15 years from now, it still comes back to this idea of if you're going to spend $100 and you're going to lose the whole $100, or you spend $50 here and you spend $50 on advertising and you theoretically get nothing in return, you're still in the exact same position that you were in. But if you do even get one shoot off of that $50, which with our marketing, I feel extremely confident you will, but just one shoot, that's what being an entrepreneur is all about. Mm-hmm. Or just not even an entrepreneur, but owning a business and understanding that, yeah, and not being afraid to invest in your business and invest, you know what, at the end of the day, you spend that money and you get no clients back for it. That doesn't mean that you lost anything. It means that you learned
well,
something.
Well, you learned your ideal client isn't wherever you put that money. Or maybe right, or your ad copy, maybe your ad copy isn't speaking to your ideal client.
Right.
So it's actually learning, so it's not necessarily bad. It's kind of like that failure, but you learn something from it. So it's actually, you did kind of get a return. You learned something.
It's just not tangible in the same way that a fancy meal or a nice night out or a fancy car or a fancy TV. It's not tangible in that way. But if you change your thinking and you start becoming a business owner and an entrepreneur, then education is the only thing it can't take away.
Yeah. I would say that we're probably going a little in depth for just photography and your photography business, but these are things that you can take forward too if you end up starting other businesses as well. So I feel like, yeah, through the boot camp, we've given you the platform to know where to invest your dollars in order to improve your business and get that proven ROI. But these are just good lessons to, you know, apply to all things in your life and any other businesses that you start. So
I know the last fear.
Last fear.
I feel like I don't know if it's the last fear, but it's a fear that every single photographer seems to have, especially in the beginning, even if their business has been around for a while. Everybody has this problem. Fear of asking for money.
Yeah. Well, that's because most photographers are creatives. We are an artist, we're very passionate about what we do, and our work is part of our passion. We give, you know, from our heart, we give from our soul, and we're people pleasers, so we want to make people happy, and that's something that we do through our art, and it's very hard to turn that into a business transaction for most creatives. So when it comes to asking for money or asking for value for the value that we've given, we tend to cringe and not want to even go there. So it's kind of more of a fear. And I have a little bit less of that because I have been doing business for a really long time. So I understand giving value and receiving value, but I still, as a creative, kind of understand where other creatives are coming from. So to address that fear, you just have to own, you know, what you're giving your clients and realize that you're giving them value and all they're doing is giving you value in return. So really, if you're delivering what you told them that you're going to give, then there's no reason why they can't give you value in return for that. So asking for money really, you don't even have to ask for it typically. Typically, when you give and you're open to receiving value in return, then it just comes. So
I think the only other time when I think some people sort of build up all of our fears are based on past precedents, meaning they're based on an experience that we've had. So when you talk to a customer, and I don't care what your price point is, your price point could be $1, and I guarantee you'll find somebody that's gonna tell you that you're too expensive because that's the way that the world works. Mm-hmm. And so pretty soon, what happens as a human being is we have a tendency to focus on these 4, 5, 6, however many people it is that told us that we were too expensive, and we forget to focus on the 1 or 2 people who said that we were too cheap, which actually happens sometimes. Or loved our prices, and they're just happy. They're happy with the value that we offered.
I would say that is definitely a big fear we should address, is photographers fear that by raising their prices or even where their prices are, they're not going to get enough clients, or if they raise their prices, they're going to lose clients, which we addressed this in the boot camp. But about when I think in week two in pricing for profit is that there are people that have different value patterns for everything. So one person that you meet might value photography and art, and they're willing to pay $2,000-$3,000 for a shoot to get what they want. But you might meet another person who values photography and art at $200-$400. And so most likely that's not going to be your ideal client, because you are running this as a business and you need to make an income. So you have to cover your expenses. So there's going to be hobby artists that are going to cover, you know, the people who don't value art that much, and they're still going to get, you know, value for value. Basically, they're not going to be the people who are detail oriented and want the most amazing pictures. They're just probably people who just want someone to capture a good enough picture for them. So understanding that there's different levels of people who value art, and you just want to find the people who are valuing art and photography at your price range. So even when you move up to your next price range, you'd be surprised that if you have built some loyal customers or loyal clients, then they will probably most likely actually stay with you. And there's going to be some that aren't, but don't fear that, because they're still going to get their photography and art needs addressed by maybe a different photographer in their value, that align with their value pattern. And you're going to bring in some new clients who are in the new value pattern and the new price range that you're at. So there shouldn't be fear of raising your prices, because there are plenty of people in the world that need photography. So I feel like that fear is also based on not knowing where to find their ideal clients and not knowing where to market. And now that you know where to market and you're going to have plenty of clients, that fear is probably going to be released a little bit.
I think it's a matter of, it's the difference of going and chasing people, and then they tell you no, and that was kind of the person that you're chasing and you thought you were going to get to do a photo shoot of, as opposed to sorting. Because when you're sorting, that means people are inquiring, you're sort of going back and forth with people, and sorting means that if they say no, then you're like, next.
We talked about that in week 5 in Sales Secrets. Your website is for kind of qualifying people. You have your information on there a little bit, they contact you, and then through your emails, you're qualifying them even further to make sure that they are your ideal client. And then once they come in for a consultation, then you're further, you know, qualifying them to make sure before they book a shoot that they understand your pricing, they understand what you're giving, and that you can understand what they're wanting, so you know if you're a good fit. So really it's about, like you said, sorting and qualifying your clients beforehand.
And also I think the other thing is, I'm not terribly good at doing this, because I have to sort of put myself in somebody else's shoes and try to imagine what it is that they're feeling, but I think that a lot of this idea of how bad that no hurts a lot of creatives especially, but really people in general, just this idea of, I threw this out there and then that person told me no and then it hurts on some level, has to do with that people take it personally. Like, you take it personally, like when they said no.
As if your art wasn't good enough.
Your art's not good enough, or you're not good enough, or they don't like you, or whatever it is.
And it's too expensive, yeah.
And at the end of the day, what you have to remember, it's like coming back to that idea that we kind of started with. The worst case scenario is, I guess, okay, maybe they don't like you. But the reality is that how many times a day do we all say no? And the reason why we all say no, however many hundreds or even thousand times a day, is because of exactly what you said, exactly what you've had in blog posts, is we just don't value whatever that is. I mean, I don't value a Starbucks coffee in the next hour. I might value a Starbucks coffee tomorrow. So if somebody offered me a Starbucks coffee right now, I would say no. That doesn't mean that I don't like them. It doesn't mean anything. It's just a no. There's lots of no's, and they mean absolutely nothing in terms of the person that you are, whether or not you're good enough, whether or not your art is good enough. It's just two people having conversations, and I feel like people are really, really bad about not having a conversation where everything is up front. It's just a conversation. Do you want this? No, I don't want this. Okay. There's nothing that you have to read in and manifest about mm-hmm. the fact that somebody said no, but that's where so many fears, I feel like, come from, is that you're reading into something that somebody's saying. They're saying no.
Yeah, as creatives, we're very passionate people, like I said earlier, and when somebody says no to us, then we do definitely take it a little bit more personally, but like you said, we shouldn't, because not only is that person maybe saying no in the moment, you never know. They may come back and say a yes. You don't know their situation at that moment. They might be a little tight on money, even though they really want to do it, and they just have to say no right now. Or they might go off and do a Groupon shoot and realize that, oh, I actually do value photography at that price range, and then they're going to come back and do a shoot with you. As long as you're kind to them. So when you come off confident too, and you're just like, okay, not a problem, then what that does is that also relays to them that you're confident in your value and you're confident in the value that you deliver. So they're more likely to come back to you that way versus if you go, oh, and your shoulders slump and you get disappointed, then it gives a completely different vibe than when you hold yourself tall and you're confident in yourself, you're owning your value, and you just say, okay, no problem. And sometimes I actually refer clients who tell me I'm too expensive to a fellow photographer who is at a lower price range. And that does two things. A, that helps them, and I'm giving them value by directing them to someone in their value pattern. And B, that sometimes allows them to go see another photographer's work that maybe is not as good as mine, and they realize that they actually want my work, so they're going to be more willing to pay for it because they go out and see the different levels of skill and the different levels of, you know, of price ranges.
They get two separate experiences, and then they can judge on the experience.
And they can choose which one is better for them. They don't always come back to me, but by me just helping them and giving them whatever it is that they need, then that just allows me to be free. I don't have to worry about anything. And by me being free and just saying, here, you know, you need a different photographer, okay, here you go, then that's just offering value. So anytime that you can just release fear and offer value, you'd be surprised how the universe works and things just start to flow to you. Just without even thinking about it, for sure.
I think that's the biggest fears and
yeah.
And
I thought of something else, but I don't remember what it is anymore. So, if you guys think of any additional fears that you have or worries that you have, definitely post in the group so we can talk about it in the weekly coaching calls. We can add it to this video if we need to, and we can just have a discussion about other fears and talk about how to address them and how to eliminate them.